Well, without question, Dick Lugar is an elder statesman. He's someone I have great respect for, someone I've voted for many times myself. But I do believe, as I've traveled Indiana in the last several years, that Senator Lugar's lost touch with the Republican base. He's certainly lost touch with the conservative element of the Republican Party. Long ago, I came to the conclusion that Republican competition in the marketplace was a good thing. And if it's good in the commercial marketplace, it's an equally good thing in the marketplace of conservative ideas. And so we issued our challenge February 22nd of last year, feel very, very good about the potential outcome. And we're delighted to see May 8th coming and feeling very good.
I've always been in touch with Hoosiers. I am a Hoosier, born here, went to school here, have 604 acres of farmland that I've been managing for over 50 years right here in Indiana. And back to whenever we're not in session, to visit all over this state with Hoosiers or to see Hoosiers in Washington who come with ideas or with problems. We are very much in touch every day of my life.
Well, we have to do two things and have to do them very quickly. Number one, we have to start to roll back the size of government so we can see the private economy begin to expand. The tax base for the United States government needs to expand not by raising tax rates, but by spurring the economy. And the thing that's slowing the economy down, and I've heard this dozens and dozens of times as I've spoken with Indiana businessmen, they are sick and tired of the regulations and the uncertainty. They need some signals from Washington, D.C. that they know what the environment is going to be. If we start to roll back the size of government, start getting the regulatory environment rolled back, I think you'll see the economy grow, generate the tax base, and then we can start whittling away at our debt, even as we start to roll back the size of government and dramatically cut spending.
We get a handle on the national debt by passing legislation such as proposed by Congressman Paul Ryan in the House. He's the chairman of the House Budget Committee. He proposed last year a budget that would cut $6.4 trillion over the next 10 years. That doesn't get us to balance, but it certainly bends the curve, moves it sharply that way. I voted for that budget in the Senate. I was one of 40 people, 40 Republicans who did so. I will do so again. But I would just say, with a Republican president and two houses that are Republican, we have a much better chance of passing either Ryan's budget or one of our own from the Senate that really does make the strong reductions in federal spending that are required, because we cannot reduce our debt without getting back to a balanced budget. And therefore I favor, as a basic construct, a balanced budget amendment to the Constitution, have endorsed that 17 times.
Under the Obama administration, the biggest foreign policy issue I think we have is just the uncertainty in knowing what his foreign policy positions are. You know, I'm startled that even to this day, now months after the fact, members of the Obama administration will say that our actions in Libya were in the national security interest. Well, other members of the Obama administration say, well, it wasn't really about our national security interest. You know, the president ought to be setting out what are those vital areas where we have a vital security interest. He hasn't done so. We need to be a lot more consistent in our foreign policy, certainly in the Middle East where we're so dependent on oil right now. We need to make sure there's peace there, and that is going to be a major area for years to come.
Our most basic issue is still terrorism, not only Al-Qaeda or Al-Shabaab or others who at least could come to the United States in one form or another and create a great deal of death and destruction in this country, that would abuse not only morale, but kill a lot of Americans and at least stymie some of our progress. I think we have good possibilities through enhanced intelligence, through better communication services, through alliances that share intelligence, of stopping the terrorist attacks and of controlling the weapons of mass destruction that are still in Russia, that are likewise available in India or Pakistan or China or various other places. There is still a lot of work to be done in terms of control of not only the nuclear weapons of mass destruction, but the biological and chemical. And this is something to which I've dedicated a great deal of time and leadership.
Well, I heard a state senator ask recently what was the biggest challenge that Indiana faces, and her response was the federal government. Just as Indiana businesses need to know what the environment is, we need to see the federal government back off, especially in the mandates that it issues to state government. What's out there with Obamacare and the potential cost to state governments? Two things are certain. It's going to be a huge number, and yet, second thing, nobody knows what the number is, except it's going to be huge. We need to start to roll back the size of government and give more power and authority to the states so they can manage the budget issues the way they see best fit.
Indiana needs jobs, and we have to have an atmosphere in this state that encourages investment, that encourages taking risks, that encourages providing the education that is required not only basically in our public schools, but likewise community college education, Ivy Tech, bridging the gap between the qualifications that employers request that have new jobs that are available and what employees potentially can offer. This is an immediate quest, and I applaud Ivy Tech, community colleges, our basic universities, likewise progressive businesses for trying to provide the training on the job frequently so that we employ Hoosiers, we get everybody back to work. But basically, we also are going to have fundamental progress in our public education system because we cannot have dropout rates that are evident in most of our larger cities of Indiana and even in some rural areas.
First thing absolutely would be to repeal Obamacare. You know, we do have some serious health care issues to be sure in this country. We need to provide more private sector initiatives in the healthcare business. So again, there's more competition there. Right now, most doctors, and I've spoken to hundreds of them around Indiana, spend hours and hours every day not treating patients, but filling out government forms. Their hands are being tied by an ever-growing federal bureaucracy that basically threatens them every day. If they don't fill out a form right, they lose part of their funding. They've made the business of medicine more about a business of dealing with the government than of actual healing. Doctors want to get back to practicing medicine. When we do that on a better basis, get the regulations out of the way, they treat more patients every day, their productivity goes up, and that will bring the cost down.
I'm hopeful that we will have extended the so-called Bush tax cuts. And these now appear to be headed for debate in the so-called lame duck session that will follow the election. This is pretty precarious because on December 31, essentially, taxes go up for every American. Likewise, inheritance taxes go up, corporate taxes, interest, all the rest of it. That could be disastrous with regard to our economic progress, quite apart from simply the day-to-day consumer patterns of ordinary Hoosiers. So, I'm hopeful that we will have solved at least the situation of extending whatever is there. But then I think we need to tackle tax reform. We need to bring about a system that encourages investment and jobs and, as a matter of fact, educational opportunities for Hoosiers. And we need this very much because we have to get back onto a pattern of growth. We already are competitive, I believe, for jobs with the states all around us. But we have a long distance to go, just in terms of per capita income growth, quite apart from very large pockets of unemployment in our state, which are unacceptable.